Bolton Wanderers and Preston North End, Wolves and West Bromwich Albion. You must, by the million of you, know the names and put one, two or X beside them every week in the football pools. But do you know the towns, football towns themselves? That's what I'm really interested in. You'll be relieved to know I'm not going to pontificate about football, because I know damn all about it. And to be quite honest, I've only ever been to one league football match in my life. But what I do know, what I am interested in, is the towns themselves. I'd like to transmit some of that. They're mostly industrial places where the real hard stuff of Britain is going on. They're mostly very great character, much greater than they're given credit for. And they're mostly unvisited, unless you have to go there on business, or in fact come to the match. Here, Bolton, all I can see in fact is the concrete top to the terraces. But if I could climb up on top of that, I'd immediately have Bolton in a nutshell. This kind of thing's put out by the town hall for the lunchtime music, and it adds a strange air of unreality to what is otherwise a very real and solid place. The town hall itself is the epitome of Victorian Bolton, the epitome of solidity, of massiveness, of brass is brass, where there's muck, there's money. The whole square here has changed completely in the last 10 years. There used to be a road across the front. Now it's all pedestrian, as is the fashion. But in this case, the fashion works. There's lots of seats. The seats are good and tough and durable, and they're well sat on. All right, that works. Fine. There's a lot more, though, than what you'd call street furniture that's gone up around here in the last 10 years. And the best of all, and the best of its kind that I know in Britain, is the Octagon Theatre. A good, tough, purple brick building expressing the shape of the auditorium outside. And done in the Borough Architect's office, too. Well done, Mr. Brooke and his assistants. There's more to the Octagon, though, than the bits which you may have seen in folk concerts, the auditorium. It's also a coffee bar, it's open all day, bar and restaurant. So it really becomes a place where you go not just for an isolated bit of culture, you know, the odd evening of Ibsen once a year, but a place where you can actually meet all the year round. And it marries perfectly with Victorian Bolton. So the town hall's fine, and the Octagon's fine with it. But all round here is what you might call the unacceptable backside of modern shopping. And especially the facades, or non-facades, to the shops on the other side. Here, the designers have just given up, which the Victorians very rarely did.
Back on the other side of the town hall square, you're down into undercover Bolton, the Arndale Centre. For Bolton, like almost any other big town, has got in for one of these covered shopping centres. The real amenity of it, especially in winter, is not just for straightforward shopping, but for people to sit and look at things, and especially to sit out of the weather. And that's a fine idea, but what worries me here is that, unlike the Victorian shopping arcades, it's terribly claustrophobic. Because the Victorian arcades kept out the weather all right, but they also let in the outside world, the daylight, top lit. This seems to be shutting it all out, enveloping you in a kind of rather unpleasant womb feeling all of its own, as though this was one special separate place and all the real town out there was unreality. In fact, the unreality I was beginning to get out there, the town hall square, is redoubled in spades here. Like going around the central feature with its fountain and the budgies. We really don't know how to do fantasy. This is all right, but it's not real somehow. And if you don't mind the paradox, fantasy's got to be real. The Victorians knew this. And my God, they were much more in need of fantasy than we are, however bad a position we're in at the moment. For in Bolton, they built a market hall with a splendid, curly, jumping, luffing iron roof. Great swirling filigree of ironwork. Something to really lift you when you went in, just go in for some black pudding or tripe. One look at that roof, it's a bit of heaven suddenly brought down here. And compared with that, even though it's a good idea, it's tiny, tiny pygmy land down here.
Back in the open out of undercover Bolton, back in the solidity of the Victorian town centre. And that centre is doing pretty well. The 20th century has treated it quite kindly compared with some other towns. The trouble is that the little streets around that used to feed it directly, just a few yards away from here, they've all gone in slum clearance. There's a kind of vacuum between the centre of Bolton and its suburbs. And that is the very end of Nuttall Street. I'm not defending these houses. If they're badly built, then they've got to go. No two ways about that. It's certainly not nostalgia for the living conditions that produced them. I am worried, though, about what goes with them when streets like this go. The sense of a street itself, an actual place with a beginning and an end. In fact, replacements just across the road here, and they're certainly not going to be disastrous. There are no massive inhuman tower blocks or anything like that. They're decent wee houses. Again, I sense, though, kind of lack of nerve in the new building, which is slightly like the lack of nerve in the Arndale Centre. I don't know, I somehow get the feeling that we're just playing out injury time somehow, and the final whistle's going to go in about 30 seconds. Well, if these houses were packed together and maybe a bit mean, the Victorians certainly looked after the spiritual welfare. Today's reading comes from the works of Sir Nicholas Pevsner, South Lancashire. It is an impressive record of local church building activity. That's in the whole of Lancashire. But of all these Lancashire men, only one had genius, Austin of Paley and Austin. And again, Bolton, St. Saviour, Dean Road, by Paley and Austin, 1882 to 1885, and one of their noblest churches. And now look at it. Pews flattened, the font in pieces, the Spirit of God still here, not gone with the congregation. You talk about football vandalism. I don't quite know how you would categorize the vandalism of the yobbers who did this. It makes me ashamed to be part of the same branch of biology. Yeah, the dry rot in the roof, there's problems, all right. But you could even leave it as a ruin, as a splendid memorial. Because this is a work of genius, and we don't mess around with them. There aren't very many of them around. Now, this is about to go. I think it'll go in a couple of months. Where the altar was, they've just left it, they haven't stripped it clean, as it were. They'd just gone away, couldn't care less. The words there, this, do this in remembrance of me.
Thank you.
do this in remembrance of me. Well, the word's got happier connotations here. This is Samuel Crompton's birthplace, the man who invented the spinning mule, which revolutionized the Lancashire textile trade. And Bolton Corporation have indeed remembered it in the best way. And not only the birthplace itself, but the whole little village here, Firwood Fold. It's one of the places that crop up a lot in the Pennines, with a huddle of houses sort of tucked in under the hills. And the whole little group is being restored by the council. The danger there, of course, is it might become too twee, but we've got to take that risk. It's certainly far better than having it all derelict. The little group forms a square, and there will, in the end, be a village green in the middle of it, where there's now just rubble. I'm sad again, this old business of old and new houses, that modern estates can't achieve this spontaneity, because the building units are really just about the same, although some of these may have mullions and bow windows and that. The whole area around here is full of surprises, epitomized by the way you suddenly fall off the edge of modern Bolton into this little remnant of the past. Down at the bottom there are factories. There's also a river which blessedly hasn't been tidied up, so it really looks like a slice of the Amazon with rapids. And beyond, straight away, the hills. This is the northern edge of Bolton. You can see the whole thing on a much grander scale. One of Bolton's biggest surprises, just up the road here, Hawleth Wood. If you think that half timber is just something that happens around Stratford-on-Avon, you've got another thing coming. There's a wonderful northern gusto about this, and it matches the stonework of the other part of the building perfectly. Crompton lived here for most of his life, not as lord of the manor, but as a caretaker. And the view from the lawns in front of Hawleth Wood is really an epitome of both Bolton and the whole of South Lancashire. It's not conventionally pretty, all this. I like it very much. It's very exciting, the fact that just everything is going on all at once. And really neither town nor industry nor landscape dominates. It's all an amalgam. Like here, the vast cooling tower neatly splitting the Bolton Parish Church and the town hall. And then, as you follow the skyline round to the north, first of all, mills in the distance. In the foreground, a vast, almost wild valley. Nature has simply been left to get on with it here, right next to the industry and the houses. And as you go further and further around, spire of a suburban church, the suburbs themselves, and finally, Winter Hill, the Pennines. The kind of view which you get all over South Lancs, and the kind of view which lifts the heart even on a really desperate day in November. Beside Winter Hill is the road to Preston. Yes, it's a bewildering place, this. It really is the north end of Preston. It must have been just about in the countryside when it was first put up. And more than anywhere else I know of football grounds, you get this astonishing feeling of emptiness when the crowds aren't here. The vast car park, the wide open spaces beyond which, ironically, are a public park completely full of football pitches. There isn't even a football pub anywhere near here, which I would think would make Preston unique. The only thing really that has scale here, the floodlights. And that's odd for Preston, because the one thing about the centre of Preston is that it has enormous scale. This is a multi-storey car park with a difference. You think that concrete exposed always has to be mean and messy. Then look at the grand sweep of this, strength and also the elegance. It's a splendid job. And this truly great building, which it is for me, is marred only, and it wasn't the architect's fault, by the underpasses. It happens so often. They're the usual white-tiled, rather claustrophobic, narrow little passages. And they are also, legally, the only way you can get here. There's a biggish notice just across the forecourt there, saying that anyone who comes in this way, that's straight across the street, is liable to be fined £5. If you want people to use a subway, make it a magnificent subway. This is the south end of Preston North End, if you see what I mean. It's the edge of the centre that you'd reach first if you came back from the football ground. And from here, right across the centre, it's possible to do a walk which every few yards is punctuated by the great blockbusters of things in Preston fashion. And the newest is only just a few paces away there, Preston Guildhall. There's nothing at all wrong with modern architecture, just with bad modern architecture. And this thing isn't going to go out of fashion. The quality of the building, which is so rare in modern architecture. These bricks, they're solid, they're there, the pointing's been carefully done. No one's going to say of this, oh, how shoddy last year's ideas. They'll recognize it was built at a certain time. It was built for 1972, just as you would say the same of a Gothic cathedral was built for 1300 or 1500. And I really am astonished, again, that a town, 100,000 people, this place is smaller than Reading, has got the pride and indeed the money to put up all these buildings and has done for centuries. Because the blockbusters are falling thick and fast around here. Just down the street there, nudging into view, is the Victorian Market Hall, which is not quite a building in the sense that it's a great big roof with open sides and it gives a magical effect of inside outside. You don't know whether you're in a room or in the street. And the roof itself is a grand bit of Victorian ironwork. Directly opposite me here is the Sessions House, which is Edwardian magnificence, early 1900s, and something which I don't quite understand happening on the top floor. If that's a courtroom, I'll eat my hat. And next to it is the real grand slam of them all, the Harris Art Gallery and Museum. This backside is grand enough. But you wait till you see the front. Just look at all that. It's the British Museum squeezed in and squeezed up. Admonitions in Greek and English. And an immense sense of purpose, of self-confidence. This, again, was done by a local man, James Hibbert. And the odd thing is that, although he built a bit around the town, he never really did anything very much. The buildings are ordinary. Yet suddenly, at the end of his life, he pulled this thing out, and pulled it out, in fact, in the style of 60 or 70 years earlier. This is 1890. To go back to the British Museum, looks as though it's about 1820 or 1830. No hell with whether it's late or early in the style, it's just a very great building. And in front of it, the marketplace, a little square, almost Parisian square with the trees there. It's the same sense of intense concentration. Still with a bit of market. The market's obviously outgrown, as you've seen the market hall there. Then across, and a bit of, not old Preston, but small-scale Preston. One tiny cottage left over, really, from Preston way before 1800. And the rest, simple, commercial up-and-down stuff. And I'm very happy to see that. Preston is so full of grand gestures that you desperately need this. It is, in fact, dead easy for me as a pedestrian to get to the next link in the grand chain of Preston. Just up there, first right and about second left. But if I started over there with a car, the only way I could do it would be somewhat different.
I wish you could go away if just for childer's sakes. For if you roam or stop a one, May y'all enjoy your week.
Traffic management on this scale for a town the size of Preston seems to me to be planning gone mad. Why not simply close the streets that have to be closed? Widen the pavements, that's a very easy thing because it both gives pedestrians more room and reduces the traffic on its own. At the moment, the pedestrians are no better off, really. There's just a strange emptiness in the centre. Though, to be fair, the scheme is only halfway through and there will eventually be pedestrian streets. This traffic scheme doesn't seem to be common sense at all. And in the end, what isn't common sense is going to be thrown out. Well, now that the camera and I have finally got here, I got here somewhat earlier, the next place is a Georgian square. It's a Georgian square with a difference, though. You see, the square is a sunken square. And it was a wonderful act of the imagination to do this. Not simply level it out, but keep the roughness of the ground and then plant it. Makes quite different from any other square I know in Britain. You can sort of lose yourself in here, but you've still got the feeling of the houses around. In fact, as I remember the story, I think it was the 1922 Preston Guilds. A couple did that. I mean, they got carried away by emotion, took off all their clothes and started performing to an appreciative audience and had to be separated by constables. The square around was built just about 1800, which was a time when very little was being built in England because of the Napoleonic Wars. But an awful lot was being built in America in the first resurgence after their little local difficulty with us. And the astonishing thing about Winkley Square here in Preston is that it really is like what they call in America the federal style, the thing you can see by the streetful in Boston and a few more of the cities of America. And this is all because of the scale. The scale is much bigger than, again, almost anything else in Britain. I know most of the Georgian squares in Britain, and apart from set pieces, like bits of Bath, bits of Edinburgh, this is the only one that can really match this federal style, really say, right, we're here. It goes right through all the streets around from here. And in a very few yards, you're out into something completely different, a massive Victorian public park. Someone seems to have made a bit of a meal of the balustrade here, but the rest of it is in perfect order. Preston keeps its legacy very well. This is the end of the journey, the end of the chain from the football ground, and it really is Preston South End. If you took all the centuries, comparing Bolton and Preston, Preston would undoubtedly win. More has happened here. It's had a longer history. It's had more time to accumulate riches in buildings. There's no point in equating them there. In fact, I like them both very much. I think they're both doing a very good job of being themselves. But I think it is fair to try and score on what the 20th century has done, the last 20 years in Bolton and Preston. So to start with Bolton, one goal for the Octagon, for the way it has become such a marvellous meeting place. Another goal for the area around the town centre, where streets have been made pedestrian, but the right streets, and made pedestrian the way that pedestrians can really use. And a very strong penalty against for what Bolton is just about to do to Saviour Church there. So halfway, if you like, the score is 2-1. Preston, again, one goal for the bus station, for its scale, for the town's energy that can put up something like that just as a bus station. Another goal in exactly the same way for Preston Guildhall. Again, the energy, the strength, the willingness to stake a lot of money in the town's future. And alas, an own goal against for the traffic system, where the fullback has just fumbled it between the goalkeeper's legs. So that, adding it all up full-time, comes out 3-3, which pleases me very much because I really do like both towns immensely. And what I'm trying to say in the programme is, please go and have a look and see if you like them as well. Don't just hammer up the motorway on the way to the Lake District. Oh, isn't it pretty? Stop off at Bolton and Preston. Don't just go up the main line from London to Glasgow. Stop off at Preston. It's quite easy. The main line runs through this park, but just over there. Next time, just change trains and have a look.